Good morning and welcome to this worship from Renfrew North Parish Church. Welcome to you if you're watching it live streamed at this very moment, and welcome to you if you're watching it later on in the day or during the week. Wherever you are and whenever you're watching, you're welcome. You have written your law upon our hearts and inscribed your love upon our lives. You have made yourself known to us in sign and symbol, in still small voice, and in the center of our souls through the song of your Spirit. And so we come, wherever we are, we come to worship you, for we are your people and you are our God. We're going to sing together, I Stand Amazed in the Presence. Just a few intimations The first is that you'll be aware that subject to the confirmation by the First Minister on Tuesday, and also subject to approval by the Presbytery, we're hoping to open for worship next Sunday, Palm Sunday. Opening at 9:30 and 11:15 for worship, and the 11:15 service will continue to be live streamed. And as with last time we were open for worship, with these restricted numbers, just up to 50, subject to the area that we have, there will be no singing, face coverings are to be worn, and we have to maintain a 2 meter distance between each other. And again, there'll be no booking system, and although we'll do our best, it may be that if you do turn up, there's a possibility that you may not be able to get in. But we're hoping to open for worship at 9:30 and 11:15 next week. And this intimation will be available on Facebook as to whether this will be happening, and also via your elders, who will also know what's going on by the end of the week. The second intimation is to do with the Raise the Roof Fund. We've nearly raised £7,500 and already close to our target of £10,000. We want to raise that amount. So please do consider giving if you haven't already, and details are available on our Facebook page. And finally, tomorrow evening is the next in our series of Bible studies, meeting at 7:30. And again, details are on Facebook, but if you'd like a Zoom link, please contact Andrew Scott at andrew.scott@renfrewnorth.org.uk. So that's for the Bible study tomorrow evening. Let's come before God in prayer. Let's pray. God, our Creator, who begot our Saviour Jesus and gifted us with the Holy Spirit, we come humbly before you to offer this time of worship. You are made known to us through the heavens and earth and all that they reveal of you. You are also made known to us through Jesus, your Son, who reveals your love for us. And you are also made known to us through the Holy Spirit, who reveals your ongoing desire for a relationship with us and who guides us in your way. We are honored to be invited to sit at your table, to be co-creators with you, to grow in love for you, and to share that love with other people. Forgive us, Lord, for those times when we have messed up, when we have failed to love or share. Forgive us, Lord, for our human frailty, our need to cling to our ego or to feed our dark side. Give us a desire to return to you in full relationship and courage to continue the work Jesus began and many since have attended to. In Jesus' name we pray. Our Lord and Saviour, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The first of our two readings this morning is taken from the prophet Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 31, reading from verses 31 to 34. The time is coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their forefathers when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will a man teach his neighbor or a man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. And then from John's Gospel, John chapter 12, reading from verse 20 through to 33. So John chapter 12, verses 20 to 33. Now there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the feast. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. "Sir," they said, "we would like to see Jesus." Philip went on to tell Andrew, and Andrew and Philip in turn told Jesus. Jesus replied, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. I tell you the truth. Unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. The man who loves his life will lose it, while the man who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now my heart is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven. "I have glorified it and will glorify it again." The crowd that was there and heard it said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. And Jesus said, "This voice was for your benefit, not mine. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out. But I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to myself." He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. Inside each of our bodies is one of these. Well, not quite like one of these. It's a little bit smaller. It's a heart. And a heart has a very useful function of pumping our blood around our bodies. But this is just a representation of a heart. Well, why have I brought this heart this morning? Well, if you remember, there was mention made in one of our readings about a heart. The prophet Jeremiah talked about a heart and talked about a covenant being written on our heart. Well, what does this mean? Well, he was talking about we live our lives as if a covenant or agreement was being written on our heart. And in this he means that we will know what is the right thing to do. That is, when we become so close to God, the closer we are to God, and the more that we focus on Jesus and not on the distractions around us, and the more that we have Jesus as our friend, then we will instinctively know what is the right thing to do and what to do when things are tough or tricky. So this was the prophet Jeremiah's way of saying, become close to God, and then all that God teaches us and all that God reveals to us will be known to us. It's as if all these things are written inside us in our hearts. We're going to sing our next song, "The Spirit Lives to Set Us Free." Walk, walk in the light. How many times have you heard the phrase, the new normal, during the COVID-19 pandemic? We sometimes talk about the fact that whenever we come out of the COVID-19 effect, one thing we cannot expect is a return to the old normal. From bigger things to smaller things, we will notice the change. Some of the change will cause us to lament the aspects of life or society that we have lost, but other changes might be very acceptable as we have, through this time, maybe reprioritized our values and the habits that we used to have. And history teaches us of the cyclical nature of society. Fashion trends come and go and come back again. And now think about music on vinyl and cassettes and CDs and downloads, and now vinyl again. And the teaching of the Bible is no different. Of course, God remains unchanged, constant, dependable, and eternal. Yet we also see that the way the people of God respond to God and how they know God changes as the story of the covenant progresses. Jeremiah comes to us in a moment of cyclical change amidst a time of crisis. Jeremiah unveils a new covenant between God and the house of Israel. But his covenant is not embodied in something visual, often used as a reminder of the covenant. We can think of such signs as the rainbow for Noah that we considered a couple of weeks ago, and the tablets of stone, or the manna from heaven, or water from the ground for Moses and the wilderness people going through the desert. We are moving here into a covenant that is not set in stone or in time and place, and is not of a covenant of one particular context of human need, but is one that is organic and fluid and adaptive to the times and challenges and needs of the moment. And this is because it is a living covenant. It is amongst the people, etched into the being of the people of God. This covenant is anchored into the heart of each living son and daughter of God. Not in outward symbols, but internalized in each one of us. It's an unmediated connection to God through the unbreakable bond of his love known in each one of us. And this kind of understanding that Jeremiah encourages is not just a covenant of theory, as if only about how we know God's love. Instead, it is about learning how we live in and through the covenant of love. For God's people, there is a knowledge and feeling of God's love that goes with us whatever we go through in life. And we find this truth not in words that are written, or in the things we are told, or the physical things that we see, but instead, the truth of God's love is found in how the words we read, and the stories we hear, and the things we see make us feel. And that feeling is the experience of the covenant, the confidence of being loved by God. Despite our extraordinary capacity to mess things up, still God comes back to us time and time again. New life and transformation comes in cycles. The living covenant is fluid and intuitive, not fixed and static. The covenant means that as God goes with us, he is not left behind on stone tablets or disappearing when the rainbow goes. God becomes present in everything that we experience. And this covenant means that God's glory is revealed in and through what we do and what we say. God's love is written on our hearts, and we become known as God's people through what we do and how we influence the society and the world around us. That second reading, the reading from John's Gospel, takes us through the tough teaching of Jesus predicting his death. And in doing so, he compares his death to the single grain of wheat falling to the ground and producing many seeds. His death is necessary so that many people will live. His death will draw people to God. His death will overcome evil and death. And his death will give the world the final covenant, the covenant sealed by his blood, and the covenant that will enable followers at least to come directly to God, to be made clean and whole, and to be able to live forgiven lives. The stories that we've been looking at through Lent, be they the teaching of Jeremiah, or the stories of Noah, Abraham, and Moses, or the stories from Jesus' life as he approaches his death, all seek to remind us that God remains connected to us. He's not distant or left behind in the wilderness or in a stone tomb. Jesus is alive. He lives on in and through us. Amen. Let's again come before God in prayer. Let's pray. Loving and living God, we come before you today with thanksgiving. We are glad to know you through your Son, Jesus. We come to offer our prayers for the world and for all those who are suffering just now. Lord, we are grateful for the relationship we have with you and all it brings us. And we pray for anyone who has yet to discover your invitation, or for anyone who has previously turned it down. Lord, may they come to know you and love you. Lord, we are grateful for all the people you have blessed, and for all the people that you have blessed us to know, and for all that those relationships mean to us. We pray for anyone who has lost touch or fallen out with a friend and who desires to reconnect and reconcile their relationship. Lord, we are grateful for all who give of their time and talents to further your kingdom, especially elders and readers, ordained local ministers, deacons, parish ministers, priests, bishops, pastors, regional and national staff, and those working locally. We pray for all who are discerning a call to serve your church in a new way. May they choose to serve and follow where you lead. Lord, we are grateful for all those who serve others in the armed forces, medical services, and the fire service, and in a voluntary way through the many charities that help other people. And we pray for all who are considering joining a service and for those who use these services and benefit from them. And loving God, in a moment's silence, we offer the people and places we know of where your presence and healing touch are needed today. And loving God, as we approach Tuesday, a year since the first lockdown, we pray for all those who have lost loved ones and friends from COVID. And we also pray for those who are still recovering, still needing your healing touch. And we pray, Lord, that you will help us to see the brighter days that are ahead. Loving God, we thank you for hearing our prayers and for promising to always answer them. Give us patience to wait and courage to serve. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Through our prayers and our readings, we always pray that we will hear the voice of Jesus. So our final hymn this morning is number 540, I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And with that confidence and in that hope, let us go in peace to love and to serve the Lord all the days of our lives. And so may the grace of our Lord Jesus, the love of God, and the companionship of the Holy Spirit go with you this day and forevermore.